Again, welcome all of you for this journey of knowing how to build a health infrastructure. So we are continuing that. So today we have two most important topics. One is quality, safety standards in the hospital and diagnostic. And this topic will be done by Dr. Lina. She's an advisory services of hospital and diagnostic, and she has got immense knowledge and experience about the quality assurance and the safety standards in the hospital to be maintained. And the second topic will be importance of accreditation, that is NABH accreditation. Earlier, we have seen fellowship accreditation from different various bodies. So now, today we'll be discussing on importance of accreditation, especially the NABH accreditation by Dr. Soumya. She is a manager for quality and medical survey administration. And today's session, we have other panelists as well, Dr. Adarsh, Mr. Raghavendra, and all our speakers will be participating. So on behalf of NNF Karnataka, we would like to give a warm welcome to Dr. Lina and Dr. Soumya. Welcome on behalf of NNF Karnataka State Chapter.
Thank you.
And
thank you today, so much.
Today we have our president of NNF Karnataka Chapter, Dr. Kotreshi sir. Can you mute in one? Sir, unmute yourself now and speak, sir.
Pardon, yeah. You can hear now?
Yes, sir. Go ahead, sir. Sir, unmute yourself. Unmute yourself, sir. We can't hear you.
Okay. Very nice, Prashant, to hear the NNF activities in Karnataka through web series. And today we have got very good advisory board at LIRA and other, who is giving a patient safety also and infrastructure and accreditation of the hospitals. It's a very essential part now, because health service is not a simple thing. It should be mandatory for everybody. Health is a right of the human thing according to Indian Constitution. So NNF is taking active from newborn to the adolescent period. So once again, I thank for the NNF Karnataka for doing the wonderful job. Through Dr. Prashant and Dilika, a very good audience also, very good speaker also. Over to Dr. Prashant, please. Over to Prashant.
So I request Dr. Lina to start the session. Over to you, Dr. Lina. I request Dr. Lina to give a brief introduction about yourself, and please start the session. Over to you, Dr. Lina.
Dr. Lina, you might be muted.
Am I audible? Hello?
Yes, you are audible. Yes.
Please. Am I audible? Yeah.
Yes.
So good evening to everybody, and thanks to Dr. Prashant and his team and GenNext for inviting me for this webinar. It is indeed an honor to be presenting in front of all the esteemed panelists and all the doctors on this group. So to introduce myself, I'm Dr. Lina Apikatla. I have done my MD in biochemistry, and subsequently I have worked in corporate healthcare sector in hospitals like Apollo, Wockhardt, Fortis and SRL Diagnostics, primarily in all the areas of quality accreditation, and I've also handled regional operations and regional business for SRL Diagnostics. So my passion is actually patient. I'm a very patient-centric person, and my passion is healthcare. And hence, I have chosen this topic of safety of patients in healthcare sector. So I hope that with this, we will be able to make our healthcare safer for all of us and for all the patients. So with that introduction, I will start my topic. So coming to patient safety facts, let's start off with WHO data of September 2019. Now, there are certain facts which are really alarming. The fact one is that one in every 10 patients is harmed while receiving hospital care. And it, in fact, it shows that in high income countries, as many as one in 10 patients is harmed while receiving hospital care. And this can be caused by a range of adverse events, with nearly 50% of them considered preventable. The second fact is that occurrence of adverse events due to unsafe care is one of the 10 leading causes of death and disability across the world. Third fact is that 4 out of every 10 patients are harmed in primary and outpatient healthcare. Unsafe medication practices and medication errors harm millions of patients and cost billions of US dollars every year. Then the fifth fact is that inaccurate or delayed diagnostics is one of the most common patients causes of patient harm, and it affects millions of patients. Sixth fact is that hospital infections affect up to 10 out of every 100 hospitalized patients. Fact 7, more than 1 million patients die annually from complications due to surgery. And fact 8 is that medical exposure to radiation is a public health and public patient safety concern. So what is the magnitude of this entire thing? So basically 4 out of 10 patients can be harmed in primary and ambulatory care settings. 134 million adverse events occur each year in hospitals in low and middle income countries. And they contribute to 2.6 million deaths annually due to unsafe care. And medication errors cost an estimated $42 billion annually. Now, this is something which none of us as healthcare providers would want to happen in any of our organizations. Hence, the importance of safety of patients in the healthcare sector. So what do we mean by patient safety? Patient safety doesn't mean that, okay, the patient comes into our hospital and is safe and he goes out. It's not just that. But the WHO definition says that it is the absence of preventable harm. So this word preventable harm puts an enormous amount of responsibility on the healthcare providers to a patient during the process of healthcare and reduction of the risk of unnecessary harm associated with healthcare to an acceptable minimum. So there are a lot of things here which we can avoid. And what is an acceptable minimum? It refers to the collective notions of, given the current knowledge, resources, and the context in which the care was delivered, which is weighed against the risk of non-treatment or other treatment. And we must understand that every point in the process of caregiving contains a certain degree of inherent hazard. Now, as healthcare practitioners, it is important for us to see that the patient is not harmed, keeping in mind our Hippocrates oath that first do no harm. So that is where the concept of safety is very important in the healthcare sector. So what do you mean by a hazard and what is a defense? So that if I make a kind of a hazard versus defense topic, then the Swiss cheese model, which was propagated by Dr. Reason, it is the most widely used model to explain system failure and analyze the medical errors. Now, this diagram, as you can see, there are holes due to basically every system in the healthcare sector has a potential for a hazard. And every system also has a defense or a barrier. And that will prevent the harm from reaching the patient. So what happens, like Swiss cheese, it is full of holes and it is also full of areas which do not have holes. So by some kind of a random event, if the holes align, then they form an open path for harm from a workplace hazard. So what do? We add layers of defense. We plug the holes and prevent them from aligning to form a path so we can stop the harm from reaching the patient. So this is called the Swiss cheese model. So now coming to what should we do about this? Medical errors have a serious public health problem. So we need to maintain a culture that works towards recognizing the safety challenges. we should not indulge in a culture of blame, shame, and punishment, but focus on system improvement. And all the individuals on the healthcare team must play a role in making the provision of healthcare safer. So why is this topic important right now? Because as I understand, we are talking about starting new hospitals or new laboratories or new OPD clinics. So whether one is building a small, medium, or large healthcare unit, there has to be a vision of incorporating safety standards right from the inception stage itself. So I'll give you an example, in a real life example from my experience. So when my previous company was a startup, wherein I joined that company, I think it was just about 2 months since the company had started, and they wanted NABL accreditation to be done within 6 months. So that placed an enormous amount of burden on the entire quality team, which I was leading. So when I saw the infrastructure, I said, okay, see, we cannot go in for an accreditation because you have so all these problems. You've got this lab over here. You do not have a proper exit. You do not have a proper entry. So the CEO of the company, he said that, okay, Dr. Leena, let us sit down and discuss what all do you want before we go in for accreditation. So all the concepts which we had in mind were built in right from day one or maybe day two. Whatever. But the main thing was that the NABL accreditation, thanks to the planning stage implementation, we were able to get it within 6 months of inception, which is a record. So that's how important it is, because all accrediting bodies look for safety standards. And even if you do not plan accreditation, some entrepreneurs may say, okay, I don't want an accreditation. But even then, it is much wiser to keep an eye on the safety as a responsible healthcare provider. So how do we keep patients safe? Now, here we have a choice. Do you want a healthcare or do you want a health coverage? So if you want healthcare, then we need to have safe practices, stringent standards, checks, and measures. Now, if I do not keep my patient safe in my healthcare facility, then I get a health coverage. Probably the next organization which does not care for patient safety will be making the TRP ratings of Times Now or Republic TV. So why? Because it attracts medical legal cases. So several accreditation bodies have a safety standard. And one of the most stringent ones being that of JCI, which is the Joint Commission International. So Joint Commission International Accreditation is one of the accreditation bodies which places patient safety as one of the primary standards in its book of standards. So I will just touch upon some of the patient safety goals which Joint Commission International has identified. So these are the international patient safety goals, which means that any accreditation, any organization which goes in for an accreditation needs to follow these. Otherwise, the audit stops over there and the assessors would go back to USA. So basically, these are the main things. These are very simple. However, it is very, very important. So the first goal is to identify patients correctly. Goal two, improve effective communication. Goal three, improve the safety of high alert medications. Goal four is to ensure safe surgery. Goal five is to reduce the risk of healthcare associated infections. And goal six is to reduce the risk of patient harm resulting from falls. So what do you mean by patient identification? Now, all of us have worked in hospitals or clinics, etc. And we see that most of the time the nurses would say, okay, this patient, bed number one, or bed number 22, Mr. Manjunath, or bed number 23, Mrs. Kanakalata, whatever. So we have to have two identifiers. We cannot identify the patient by the room number or the bed number. The patients have to be identified by two identifiers, which has to be numeric. And this identification has to be done each and every time the patient receives a medication, a blood or blood product, collection of specimen for a lab test, a diagnostic imaging, or receive a treatment or a procedure. This sounds simple, but many of the times it is not. It may not be done. Then IPSG2 stands for verbal and telephonic communication. wherein, and also the reporting the results of critical diagnostic test, handover communications. So this is also one interesting thing which we may have seen, many of us, that when the shift gets over, the nurse is supposed to hand over, or the technician is supposed to hand over the entire thing to the next technician who comes in. But what happens normally is that they hand over four patients, but by that time it's already 9 o'clock and the nurse has already crossed the shift. So the second nurse comes in and there's a bit of a gap, that is a slip. So the ball slips over there, and that stage is very much prone to errors. And most of the error-prone communications are verbal orders and reporting critical test results. So to give an example, sometimes you can say that the glucose value is, say, 70, and then somebody writes it as 80 or 90, and then there is a error. So how do you make it error proof? You say it is a 70 instead of saying 70, or instead of saying 11, instead of saying 100, you say 100. So these kinds of things have to be developed by training to the hospital authority, to the hospital staff. Now the hospital needs to maintain a list of critical tests, the values, who is authorized to receive and report the critical values, what is the process for documenting the same, the process for handover, and documentation of the handover. These are important things which will improve the effectiveness of communication. Now coming to another very important area, that is high alert medications. So high alert medications cause several sentinel events in hospitals, and they also cause medication errors. So medications that carry a chance of error are called LASA, that is look alike or sound alike. So they are visually similar in packaging, they are similar in spelling, similar phonetics. For example, ephedrine, epinephrine, cetirizine, sertralin. So these kinds of things has to be stored properly in the pharmacy. Now, this brings us to, again, the infrastructure requirement for a pharmacy. You need to have a pharmacy which is big enough and which has adequate space and partition so that you can store your look-alike, sound-alike drugs in a different section. And also, you need to identify and locate and label and store the high alert medications. And the process of identification should be the same across all the hospital areas. For example, if you are writing high alert medication in red all across the hospital, then it should be maintained as red. You cannot change it to yellow, or you cannot change into orange just on a random desire. So you need to have the similar kind of a cupboard or a similar kind of lettering or on lighting, whatever it is, all which should be the same all across the hospital. Now coming to safety of the concentrated electrolytes. All concentrated electrolytes have to be removed from the patient care areas and stored in the pharmacy. Now this is something which is very difficult, because whenever you administer to the patient if there is a requirement, then there's a very high chance of leaving it on a table or on a bedside table or something, and that is liable to be misused. So there has to be a policy. If at all a concentrated electrolyte cannot be stored in a patient care area, then it should be permitted by policy, and it should be clearly labeled. And all medications, even when kept in syringes, should be labeled. See, these are all very difficult things, I know. But the thing is that whenever you're planning a hospital or any kind of a healthcare sector, then at least the training should happen so that the staff slowly become acquainted with all this. Now, what is the next one is the correct site, correct procedure, and correct patient surgery. So we have all heard of many horror stories wherein the wrong site and the wrong patient has been operated on and all that. So how do you prevent this kind of an unsafe practice? So there are very important things here. One is that you take a timeout. So what is a timeout? So JCI makes it mandatory for a timeout, which is an important pause by the entire surgical team to confirm the correct patient, procedure, and site. So this is a time when just prior to the surgery, and the time out has to be done. So the correct patient, is it the correct procedure, is the correct medication being given, and all the doubts have to be cleared at this point of time. And then finally the timeout is signaled, like in the picture you can see the doctor who signals a timeout, and then the surgery starts. So this, and then the surgical marking site is also very important. So it should be easily identifiable. And ideally, if one doctor, one surgeon is marking it as a cross, then it has to be uniform and similar. So it cannot be that one doctor identifies it as a cross and the second doctor identifies it as a circle and so on and so forth. So it should be similar all across the organization. So you have a surgical checklist also, surgical safety checklist, and surgical checklist has a proper document whether the site is marked or not, and all the anesthesia machines are working or not. Everything has to be a part of the surgical checklist. So this starts before induction of anesthesia, and before skin incision you have certain checklist, and before the patient leaves the operating room again, so that an inadvertent leaving the swabs in the abdomen and stuff like that do not happen. Then the next IPSG is the reducing the risk of healthcare associated infections. Very important, especially in the COVID times, and hand hygiene guidelines. And now all of us know the importance of this. In fact, I remember a time when we were a part of the hospital infection control committee, and we had to actually train people in hand washing. How do you wash hands? And most of the nurses and all, and the technicians didn't want to remove the rings and the full sleeve dresses and stuff like that. So, and I'm surprised now that within the last 6-7 months, all of us have become so conscious about hand washing that I don't think any further training may not be required to teach somebody to hand wash. But last year itself, I remember that we were going around in the hospital training people to how to do the correct hand washing. So that is the kind of a side effect of this COVID pandemic. So this is very important. I think 20 seconds can save our life. So that's how important it is. And okay, now this is also something which is related to infrastructure. So this is IPSG6, which reduces the risk of patient harm from falls. Now, most of the time when you enter a healthcare facility, many places do not mark that this is a fall risk zone. So the infrastructure of the hospital or the OPD or the clinic has to be very, very specifically marking how the patient, what are the fall prone and the injury prone zones. So how do you do that? So there are certain risky locations like staircase, slippery surfaces, ramps, etc., which have to be marked. Now and then also you need to have grab bars. The planning of the restrooms has to be done in such a way that the grab bars are present. Then the end of the steps of the staircase should be marked with a bold red line. Then nurses' call bells have to be present near the patient beds. Very often we may see that the nurses' call bell is present, but it may not be working. So how do you stop that? Now you need to have an audit every now and then that the nurses' call bell is working. And also one interesting observation I can share here with everybody is during a JCI as an audit of one of the hospitals I have worked for, the assessor, so everything was ready, everything was spick and span. And the assessor said, fine, let me now go and check the nurses' call bells. So all of us were very confident that we had the call bells and they were all working. So when she went and pressed the nurses' call bell, she was actually looking at the time. Now, none of us had thought of that. We had seen that it was spick and span, it was scrubbed and everything, but we never realized that she would see the time within which the nurse is responding. So when she pressed the nurse's call bell, the nurse knew that, okay, there is a call bell, but she did not come within, hardly 10 or 20 seconds, or I think 20 seconds is what they were looking at. So the nurse did not turn up within 20 seconds. And then she came after a minute and she said, no, I was doing something. So the assessor said, see, you have everything, but it should be practically implemented. So this is a lesson which we all learned on that day of the audit, that whatever is there should be also working. And the response time also should be monitored properly. So these are certain things, and also the visual identification of a fall. If a patient is at a high risk of a fall, he or she should be marked with a visually, very kind of a fluorescent band, which would identify him or her to be at risk. Now, this is very important for the people who want to plan out a hospital, because there are facility management standards which also ensure safety. So here what happens is the hospital needs to comply with certain building laws, regulations, fire safety codes, and also have a written program for the risk management process. So what happens during normal audits is that the JCI assessors would go around looking at the facility. So the facility, for example, once I remember this, I can share because all of us are healthcare professionals here. So what we had done is typically in the case of audits, we had kept some kind of hazardous material locked up in a cupboard. And so the facility management officer and I, we were accompanying the assessors, and she said, can I know what's inside that cupboard? Then we said, no, that's not being in use. Actually, we had stuffed a lot of some kind of, gas or something like that, cylinders or something. I don't recollect what, but it was something hazardous. So she said, can I look into that cupboard? Then we said, no. That cupboard is not in use, but she was very persistent. And finally, we had to get the key and open it. And all of us were left shame, kind of a red faced, seeing that we had stuffed some kind of thing into a cupboard and we didn't want the assessor to be. So that was one of the first JCI audits. And then we all realized that it's better to, be open rather than try to hide something. So these kinds of things are very interesting during an accreditation, and it all sort of helps us to learn more. And the last point here is that, when planning for a demolition, construction or renovation, the organization also conducts a risk assessment. So here, this is the hazardous material cupboard, which we have. And then there has to be a plan for disaster management. The disasters can be a COVID-19, or it can be an earthquake, it can be a band, the Karnataka band or Bharat band, whatever. But there has to be a plan for a disaster management. And also fire, very important. Many a time we have seen that fire causes, I think all of us know that in many hospitals, there have been cases of fire and which have been quite brutal with the patients. So fire safety is a very important part. So whenever we are planning out a hospital, then you need to also see that there is a fire exit. Now, normally we have seen that most of our buildings may not have a fire exit. So in the next slide, I will tell you a real life example wherein there was a fire exit which was sort of not functional. So fire safety is very important for building safety. So whenever a building is established, their fire safety regulations has to be there. The Karnataka or the government, whatever state government is there, has to endorse that the building is safe. Then also we have medical equipment. Hospital establishes and implements a program for medical equipment. This I think all of us know that it is very important. Then utility like water, electricity, then facility management and safety, and most important is staff education. So staff education is the main thing which can stop unsafe practices from creeping into the healthcare system. Now, coming to the neonatal ICU, the reason I'm talking especially about the NICU is because obviously we have this, we are a part, the entire Karnataka Neonatal Foundation is here. So the neonatal intensive care unit is a unique and complex environment. And here the safety, which I have seen in our audits, is that mostly there is a medication error. It is not because of lack of knowledge, but it is because mostly because the baby's the dosage is not written down for the. It's a very it's actually something very simple, but it doesn't happen. So medication errors happen because the dosage will not be written down, and a junior person may come and see that, okay, I don't remember the dose, something of that sort, and that is very frequent happens in the neonatal ICU. And 57% of medical errors occur in 24 to 27 weeks of gestation. Then also misidentification errors. So what happens is in the NICU that about the identification bands are there, and they are all tiny babies. So the identification bands are removed to place the IV lines. So and the babies also sort of remove it, and the nurses also remove it. So the babies are at risk. So I'll tell you one example of a fire exit in the NICU, which had created a problem. So in this hospital, the NICU had a corridor. The NICU was actually a very well-planned place, and it was only there was one entry and the same exit. Now the entry and the exit both were into a corridor, and the fire exit was leading from the corridor. So in so we thought that, okay, it is a very well, everything else was there. It was a very well-planned, modern NICU, but this was a small thing which we hadn't realized. So when the accreditation, when the audit happened, the assessor led us through this, and she said, okay, I want to see what are you going to do if there is a fire? So there are babies here, neonates, small babies. What are you going to do about it? So we said, okay, then we'll run out through the fire exit. She said, who is going to run out of the fire exit? Will the babies run out? No. So it is one or two nurses or doctors who are going to physically take the babies and come out of the NICU. So how do you expect a person holding 8 or 9 babies in their hand coming out of the NICU with this corridor arrangement? So it was such an eye-opener for all of us. And immediately we had to it would have been a major non-compliance. So immediately the entire NICU had to be renovated and the separate door created and all that. So this is something which we do not realize while planning a hospital. We think that, okay, everything is in place, but this is a minor thing. So when you do it practically, then you realize that, okay, it is not possible actually in a situation. Then similarly, there is a code PINK, which most of people would be knowing, which is an emergency code, which is used to activate a set of action in case a child, a neonate or an infant is missing from the hospital. So this is also one more example I can give. It was not in the ICU, it was in the pediatric ward, wherein a woman had delivered twins. And as is usual in our families, so there were a group of people who had come to visit the woman for seeing the babies. So the twins were next to the lady's bed. And once the family left, so the lady didn't realize because she was asleep. And a very alert junior nurse came and saw that there's only one baby there. So instead of the twins, so since the mother was asleep and father was also gone to see of the relatives, there was only one baby. So this alert nurse immediately raised a code PINK, and luckily it turned out that it was actually very embarrassing because one of the family members who probably wanted a baby or a son or something of that sort had taken the second child and sort of gone out. But because of this alert nurse and code PINK, immediately the baby could be retrieved. Now, baby abduction is not something very common, but if it happens, it can bring an organization down to its heels. So a code PINK is very essential to have within the in a pediatrics or a neonatal ward. Now, coming to the lab errors, which also I should touch upon here, because laboratory report is very important, and the safety part of it has to be taken into consideration. So in a laboratory, I think many people would know that there are about 5 phases. So previously we were studying about pre-analytical, analytical and post-analytical, but now it is changed to pre-analytical, which comprises the test request, the patient and specimen identification, blood drawing, sample collection, transportation of sample to the lab. Then the pre-analytical part of it is once the sample enters the lab, there is the centrifugation, aliquoting, pipetting and all. Then an analytical part of it, which is the sample analysis. Then post-analytical, where the results are verified and the results are entered into the LIS. And the post-post-analytical is where the clinician receives, reads, and interprets the results, and the clinician makes the decisions on the result. So from a study done, it has been seen that maximum errors which lead to problems in the laboratory happen in the pre-analytical phase, and then subsequently in the pre-analytical, and again in the, some errors happen, about 19-20% happen in the post-analytical phase. So this is a thing, I wanted to actually share some real life examples with everybody so that, you know, it the whole set, can understand how all these safety standards are so important in ensuring that our patients receive the best care. So this is something which had happened in one of the labs, and I'll just tell you about it. So this was the sample of a patient, so call him Mr. A, which came to the lab from the dialysis unit for blood tests, including hepatitis B. Now, the technician on duty, she processed the sample on hepatitis B rapid test card, and she got a positive report. Now, in the meantime, as is usual in a busy hospital, there were multiple calls from the dialysis unit for the report because patient was anxious and wanted to leave immediately. So he communicated the positive result to the dialysis unit. So based on this, the patient underwent dialysis on the machine, which was meant for positive cases. So in this particular hospital, there was a separate machine for the infectious, for the hepatitis B positive patients, and a separate one for the negative. So because of the positive report, the patient underwent dialysis on the positive machine meant for positive cases. So soon after, a senior technician came and she repeated the test because actually, and as per protocol, all the positive tests are to be repeated. So she repeated the test and unfortunately the result was negative. So by this time, the patient had been potentially exposed to hepatitis B due to dialysis on the positive machine. So this became a huge problem. And so if you analyze what went wrong, what are the safety standards which were violated? Now, the main thing was there was a root cause analysis done, and it turned out that HBsAg rapid test card was not labeled with patient name and hospital ID. The vacutainer was labeled, but when he put it on the card was not labeled. So inadvertently, the card of the negative patient was mixed up with the card of the positive patient. Now, the positive test was not repeated. And normally critical hepatitis B positive is supposed to be a critical alert, which has to be communicated to the clinician. But because of the hurry and the rush and the frequent calls, etc., the positive test was not repeated. And the technician did not follow the protocol of reporting the critical result. The senior technician came, followed the correct protocol, but by that time, the patient care has been compromised. So this is something, I mean, of course, there was a lot of hue and cry and usual problems, but this is a violation of the safety. Now, the next example I can give is an incorrect glucose result. So here what happened was constantly the clinicians were complaining of the wrong glucose reports. And biochemistry department of the hospital was very puzzled and they did all the troubleshooting methods, but they did not rectify the issue. So finally, they did a focused quality audit. And it was seen that the refrigerator temperature had not been monitored. Nobody actually bothered, although it is a part of the safety protocol, by due to reasons like being busy or a technician coming late, whatever, the refrigerator temperature had not been monitored. The kit had lost its stability. The QC trend also showed a drift away from the baseline, but it had not been acted upon the staff. There was a staff shortage. People were working double shifts. The entire thing had happened and the glucose had lost the stability, wrong glucose reports were being reported, and all glucose kits had to be discarded and all the patient results had to be repeated. Now, this is something one of us want. Had the technician, although safety protocols are there, it was not followed. So what went wrong? Refrigerator temperature monitoring was not taken seriously. Staff shortage was not handled adequately. So overworked staff are often a source of errors. Now this brings us to the manpower planning for the hospital, wherein you need to have adequate manpower, especially in critical areas like ICUs, labs, etc., wherein you cannot afford not to have adequate manpower. And quality checking should be more stringent. There's another example of an erroneous PTA-PTT value. So this was a patient in the neuro ICU under heparin medication being monitored by APTT values, and the lab results were consistently below the critical range, hence dosage was given. And after 3 days, the patient developed symptoms of a cerebral bleed. There was a multidisciplinary committee, the case was discussed, and it turned out that the APTT values were being done, APTT tests were being done on a semi-automated machine, values were not standardized, and false low values were reported. So what went wrong? See, this was a cost-saving exercise. Now, this cost-saving exercise is fine, but it should not be done on a critical test equipment. So machine calibration, INR values were not standardized. Then clinical correlation was not there between the lab and the neuro ICU. So an FMEA or a failure mode analysis was done for all this, and the entire the risk assessment was done. Of course, after a lot of heartburn from the patient's family and from the treating doctor and the lab director. A breast mass, similarly, a benign breast lump got reported as a malignant one due to a mix-up. So what happened here? Now they did a root cause, a fishbone diagram, also called an Ishikawa diagram. So several histopathology slides were kept on one slide tray, mislabeling of two specimens. So this could have been prevented. If you had lesser number of slides, instead of just dumping the slides on one tray, then this could have been probably could have been prevented. We cannot say yes. So these are certain technical errors which have led to problems with the patient care, and these all could have been preventable. So apart from the technical part, we also should look at the facility safety, like chemical hazard, hazmat cupboard, MSDS, eye wash station, and chemical spill kits, physical hazards, there can be ergonomic hazards, biological hazards like blood and body fluids exposure, blood-borne infections, and safety hazards. So all this, now normally laboratories are located in the basement. So I remember a time when an autoclave was kept in the basement and it exploded. So the autoclave actually should not be kept in the basement of a lab. It should be, it should not be kept in the basement of the building. It should be kept outside, most of the hospitals are a little crowded and the labs are always confined to the basement. So what happens is the autoclave exploded. Luckily, there was no one working there. But these things can happen. So all this which I have told, now we can say, an entrepreneur or a hospital owner can say, fine, I have invested this much of money on my hospital. Why should I get it? Why should I implement a grab bar? Why should I implement a fire exit or whatever and all that? And why should I keep so many staff? Don't I save money on manpower? Don't I save money on building a thick fire exit door? So no. Now, what we have seen is when you invest in patient safety, it can lead to significant financial savings. It can lead to better patient outcomes. And cost of prevention is much lower than the cost of treatment due to harm and the lawyer fees and the pain of medical legal cases. So in United States, I don't have data from India, so I had to take US data. So focused safety improvements led to an estimated $28 billion US dollar savings in Medicare hospitals. And also you need to involve the patient in safety. So if the patient knows that I have, to some extent, I've been given this medication for so and so reason, and I may develop a side effect which is like this, then you are in a better condition to help the patient. And when you educate the patient, it is not expensive. It is a good value. And you can also reduce the burden of harm by up to 15%. And this is a very good return on investment. So we should never be afraid of, building a ramp somewhere or building something which may lead to an extra expenditure. But in the long run, it really adds value to the hospital and to the entire healthcare system. So I can conclude by saying that planning for safety should start from the stage of planning for a facility. All providers must accept that there is a potential for errors in healthcare environment. We cannot say that, I'm doing it so there can be no errors. We need to accept it, there can be an error. And how do we stop the error? Effective communication related to medical errors will improve the patient safety. And error reporting cannot be a blame game. I cannot say that, okay, I'm not at fault and it is the other department which is at fault. It cannot happen like that. It is only for better patient care. So everyone needs to be tuned towards that. And so ultimately, we need to keep each other safe and entire healthcare system should be safe. And that is why we follow the principles of safety in patient care. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Leena. So the message is very clear. There is no compromise when it comes to quality and safety of the patient. It doesn't matter what it costs. We are all working to make sure that the safety of the patient and safety of the staff is at most paramount importance. Thank you for enlightening us. So we'll move on to the next session. After the second topic, we'll take up all the questions from the audience. So thank you once again for your wonderful, elaborate, brief, precise presentation. So now I request Dr. Soumya to start her session. After her session, then we will go for discussion and question and answers from the questions from the delegates. Over to you, Dr. Soumya.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Dr. Prasha.
Thanks, Dr.
Thank you.
Minimum, can you stop your share?
Dr. Soumya, I request you to give a yes, Dr. Soumya. I request you to give a brief introduction about your experience, and then start the session. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Prashant. Good evening to one and all. Before proceeding, just a brief introduction about myself. I'm Dr. Soumya MV. I'm working as Manager Medical Administration and Quality for Cloud9 Group of Hospitals. Previously, I've also worked for Apollo Group of Hospitals, Banerghatta Road. My primary interest has always been into operations and quality in particular. So that's about a brief introduction about me. I am very much passionate about looking at accreditation and, of course, beyond accreditation, all the other quality improvement initiatives that we can implement at the organization level. Yeah. So before moving ahead with my session, I would like to extend my gratitude to NNF for giving me an opportunity to be presenting my session today and for having me here. Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Leena. That was a wonderful session. It gave a lot of insights about patient safety, something which I'm passionate about as well. Thank you so much. So starting off, of course, what you see here are symbols of excellence, symbols of validation and quality assurance and pride to organizations. So what would I be talking about today is the importance of NABH accreditation. NABH, as most of you know, stands for National Accreditation Board for Hospitals and Healthcare Providers. Now, what are the things that I would be covering in my session? A brief history of accreditation, both in the international context and the national context. What are the different types or what are the different programs that is covered under NABH accreditation? The process of NABH accreditation itself, looking at quality of care from a broader perspective, what are the benefits and the challenges in the accreditation process? So I think before we go ahead and delve into all the different concepts that was mentioned in the previous slide, it is very important for us to understand, what is an accreditation, especially in the context of a hospital. So if I have to define a hospital accreditation, what is it? It is a public recognition of the achievement of accreditation standards by a healthcare organization that is demonstrated through an independent external peer assessment of that organization's level of performance in relation to these standards. So simply put, you're doing a self-assessment and you're also having an external peer assessment process. And this basically assesses your level of performance in relation to the established standards. And what is very, very imperative for us to know is it always looks for ways to continuously improve as an organization. This is something which is very, very important. Even before understanding what is the importance of NABH accreditation and what is NABH accreditation as of today, very important to understand what is the origin, like where did it all begin? Starting off with the international accreditation. So this gentleman in my slide is Ernest Amery Codman. So he was a surgeon, and he always believed in this lifelong pursuit to establish an end result system. In fact, he's acknowledged as a founder of what today is known as outcomes management in patient care. He was the first person to the mortality conferences. He was the first person to initiate the hospital standardization program. So what he was basically interested was in creating a database of all his patients, patient outcomes, so that he could use that as a foundation to treat his patients in the future. So he basically wanted all the outcomes of patients to be documented somewhere. He also lost his privileges as a consultant only because he planned to evaluate a surgeon's competence. Of course, he was also stripped of his privileges, but he went on to becoming one of the founding members of the American College of Surgeons, and where, of course, he developed the program of minimum standards for hospitals. And later in 1951, this led to the formation of the Independent Joint Commission on Hospital Accreditation, or what we know as the Joint Commission on Accreditation of Healthcare Organizations. Now, the reason why this is so important is all the other subsequent national programs have been derived from this either directly or indirectly. And for a man to have a vision like that almost a century ago is something which is commendable. Closer home, how did this journey of NABH accreditation take its roots in our country? So this was basically a question which was posed in the parliament to the Ministry of Tourism. So the question was whether we could come up with a uniform national structure in order to evaluate our healthcare services so that there is an assurance that the patients can seek when it comes to patient safety and quality when they come to our country and avail our healthcare services. So they're basically looking at a uniform structure and accreditation structure which will validate the healthcare services in our country. Then, of course, it was taken up with the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare Government of India, who routed it through the QCI, and thus we had NABH, which originated. The first blueprint for NABH was basically formulated on 19th January 2006, and we had the first launch of the NABH standards on 1st of February 2006. And the rest, like they say, is history. So every 3 years, they've had a revision of standards. And right now, we are in the fifth edition of NABH standards. So like I said, NABH is a constituent part of the Quality Council of India, which, again, was a non-profit autonomous body that was created and that was formulated in order to drive the quality movement in India. They have various accreditation boards. Of course, our primary focus today would be on National Accreditation Board for hospitals and healthcare providers. The reason I've put ISQO here is the standards for NABH has been accredited by ISQO. ISQO, as I think most of us know, stands for International Society of Quality in Healthcare. And once you are accredited by this, it means that your standards are now on par with the other global accreditation standards for healthcare. They also have been founding members of ASQA, and not many of them know, but NABH has actually gone ahead and they have NABHI, and Philippines is one of the first countries, which has actually been open to an accreditation from NABH on an international level. And that is something that I think all of us must be proud of. So these are some of the accreditation programs. Of course, this is just the screenshot of the various standards that they have. So just to summarize, NABH accreditation, of course, has three different buckets. You have the accreditation programs in itself. You have certification programs and the empanelment programs. And as you can see, there are around 11 accreditation programs, 8 certification programs and empanelment programs. So when we talk about the empanelment programs, it is more to do with the CGHS and the ECHS scheme. So like any other accreditation program, there are certain cardinal principles on which the accreditation evaluation is based. So before moving on to the process of the NABH accreditation itself, so what are these cardinal principles is what we're looking at. hospital operations are based on sound principles of a system-based organization, which are transparent and objective. Accreditation standards are implemented and institutionalized into the hospital functioning. What it means is basically your standard should be a way of work, a way of functioning of your organization. Patient safety and quality of care would be the core values, and it is something which is driven by everybody in the organization, including the management and all its staff, and at all levels. There is a structured quality improvement program based on continuous monitoring, including feedback on patient care services. So this is the NABH overview. So what I'm referring to here would be the full-fledged NABH accreditation, which is basically the fifth edition. So again, we have 10 chapters in here. The first five usually are referred to as the patient-centric standards, and the last five would be the hospital or the organization-centric standards. Now, they have moved on from continuous quality improvement being rephrased as patient safety and quality improvement. So NABH accreditation standards across, irrespective of whatever accreditation programs or the certification programs that they have, they basically have chapters, standards, and objective elements. Now, when it comes to a standard, the easiest way to understand a standard is that it is a statement of expectation. Now, it might be as simple as saying that your organization has a documented admission and a registration process, or a registration and an admission process. So that is what I would expect. Now, when I talk of an objective element, now what is an objective element? It is a measurable component of a standard. So what are the things I would measure for me to ensure that your organization has basically fulfilled this standard? So do you have a documented protocol? Do you have a process in place and it is well implemented, wherein you do not, you know what to do when there is a non-availability of bed? Do you have a unique identification number that is generated for every patient at the end of a registration? Do you have an adequate transfer process in place? So all these things would be the objective elements based on which I would see if the standard has been met with or not. Now, in the fifth edition, what they've done is there is a slight change between the previous edition and the new edition. In the fourth edition, they had 102 standards and 686 objective elements. Now, they've come down to 100 standards and 651. So what they've done is each of these objective elements have been further classified into the categories called as the core category, a commitment category, achievement category, and excellence category. So each of these categories, of course, you will have the core category, which is assessed in all of the assessments. Then you'll have 459 of which are in the commitment category, which is only during the final assessment, 60 which would be in the achievement category, and then that's during the surveillance, and the rest of it, which is about 30, and that will be assessed during the reaccreditation. So just to give you an overview of the process, so like how I said, understanding that what they would look at is continuous quality improvement. Accreditation is not a one-time process. Once you're accredited, the validity is for 3 years. So they come back in between for a surveillance, which is between at around 15 months, that's 1.5 years. And then you again will have to go for a reaccreditation at the end of 3 years. Of course, these would be different when it comes to the certification programs and the other programs. Now, there is minimum criteria. Of course, the criteria has changed now because of the fifth edition. But mostly, even in case of small healthcare organizations, the criteria for accrediting a small healthcare organization or a hospital would still remain the same. The legal requirements have to be met with. This is something which is non-negotiable. And like I said, no individual standard should have more than 10. The average score for a standard should not be less than 5. The average score for a chapter should not be less than 7. So your overall score for the organization should be more than 7. Basically, that means it should not be less than 7. So this is the NABH accreditation process, where you apply and then there is scrutiny of the application. And then, of course, you have the toolkit, the pre-assessment, final assessment, review, and so on and so forth. Just to make it easier, I have basically put what we need to look at, you know, when we look at the NABH roadmap, what are the different stages of an accreditation process. So any hospital, I think like how Dr. Leena was also mentioning, a gap assessment or, you know, whatever you're planning, you're basically setting a roadmap for the accreditation process. And this is one of the most crucial steps in an accreditation process, because it is very important to identify the gaps. So these basically gaps are identified by using your self-assessment toolkit or your standards itself as a reference. Your reference document for doing a gap assessment would be the NABH standards itself. Now, what they would look at is, once you know where your organization stands, you would then initiate the implementation of a standard for a minimum period of 3 months. You go ahead and do the self-assessment, which is basically filling up the self-assessment toolkit and, of course, all the other mandatory documents that you have to fill along with the application form. So once you do that, there is an initial scrutiny of the application form, all your documents, all your policies, licenses, and your self-assessment. And then you have the assessors who are assigned. So then they would come for a pre-assessment. Again, the number of mandates that would be required for an assessor or for a group of assessors to do an audit would depend on the kind of accreditation program that you have chosen. Now, if you're a hospital which is more than 50 beds and you would like to go for a full-fledged one, then you would come under the purview of a full-fledged, that is NABH SHCO standards. Now, if you're less than 50 beds and you again want to go for the full-fledged one, you will be governed by the second edition standards. So your mandates and the number of assessors also would depend on the kind of accreditation program that you would choose. So they would finish the pre-assessment, give you the non-compliances. Once there is closure of entries, once there is closure of the non-compliances, again, what happens is you will have to upload all these evidences against each of these non-compliances. There is a review which is being done by the assessor. Once he gives us a go-ahead, then you are eligible for a final assessment. And then the same process repeats, except that at least for a small healthcare, the number of mandates would be 2 days. Okay, and you'll have 2 assessors who would come in for the final assessment, and then there is closure of NCs. Again, the number of mandates and the number of assessors that we have would vary from one accreditation program to another. Now, once you have the non-compliances which have been documented by the assessor and the report has been submitted, you again repeat the exercise of submitting the evidences. Once these evidences against each of these non-compliances have been reviewed by the assessors and then they give a go-ahead, it is not that we get the NABH accreditation, because you will have to submit all these documents to a committee which is called as an accreditation committee. And only once the accreditation committee is okay, after reviewing all your legal compliances along with the NC closures and, of course, a set of mandatory documents that they would ask, only then we would be receiving the accreditation. And like I mentioned, most of the accreditations would be valid for a period of 3 years. In between, they would be coming for a surveillance assessment. Now, of course, because of COVID, they have started off with the desktop surveillance. Apart from surveillance, there are also different types of audits that NABH would undertake. One, of course, would be the focus audit. Focus audit is in case you have changed the facility or if you have had a change in the scope of service, they would come for an assessment. The other one is called as a surprise audit. So if NABH would like to do a surprise audit, or if they've had a negative feedback about your organization, they would come back and do a surprise audit of your organization. And of course, then you have a reaccreditation, which happens only after those period of your accreditation, which is for 3 years. Now, the reason why I have added this particular slide here, where I'm going to be talking about quality of care, is to see how the various factors basically contributed to the journey of accreditation in India. Like NABH as we see it today, first, of course, we understood what was the origin, what is the process, but what were the different factors which actually contributed to the entire journey of accreditation? I think most of us here are well aware of WHO and universal health coverage, which is basically about ensuring that all people have access to the needed health services, of course, of sufficient quality. And this is one of the priority objectives of WHO. Then we also had sustainable development goals, which was a part of the UNDP. And this was, of course, rolled out in 2015. And what it does is they're also called as global goals. They have 17 goals and they have 169 targets. And goal three is something which gives emphasis on ensuring healthy lives and promoting well-being for all at all ages. So if you go through the website, you can also go through the different targets that they have set for the member countries, which they will have to achieve by 2030. Then, of course, closer home was the IRDA regulations, which came into effect in 2016, wherein there was a mandate that was passed saying that all the hospitals which wanted to avail cashless services would obviously mandatorily have the NABH accreditation, at least at the entry level. So I think all these factors, because when you look at quality of care, you understand that all of these put together has impacted the journey of accreditation, because somewhere to achieve these goals, to achieve universal health coverage, they saw accreditation as a roadmap, as a framework to basically get there. Now, when the IRDA regulation was actually rolled out, you know, let's just not talk about the private hospitals, but this was seen as a huge step in the delivery of healthcare at the grassroots level. So what they were trying to do is use insurance companies to drive patient safety. So this is, of course, from the broader perspective. Now, if you look at any accreditation program or the standards in which they are structured, you realize that the basis or the foundation for this would be a Donabedian model in healthcare quality. It is basically a conceptual framework which says that if you have to evaluate a quality of care, so you can do it using these three factors: structure, process, and outcome. So if you look at any of these standards, you know, apart from all the technical terms of chapters, standards, and objective elements, you realize that if you would want to evaluate a quality of care, all of those parameters would fall, of course, into either of these buckets, which is either your structure, either your process, and either your outcome. So when you have all of these which are aligned and which function in, of course, the interrelationship between all these factors happen in a balanced way, then you know that you have a good quality of care. Structure, like how it is put in the slide, basically refers to all the physical characteristics, the infrastructure where you're delivering healthcare. Process would be basically focus on the care which is delivered to the patients or all the touch points of patient care delivery. Outcome is effect, of course, the effect of healthcare on the status of patients and populations. So just to give a little more detailing into this, so structure would be all your statutory compliances, your infrastructure, resource allocation, accessibility to your hospital. Process, of course, so when I take a system, all of us know that you have many subsystems which impacts the care of patients, either directly or indirectly. So I have all the processes, all clinical, all non-clinical processes which govern the patient-provider interaction. So it can be, of course, one of the examples here is an inventory management. So it can be either patient related or not patient related, but ultimately it is going to impact patient care. Outcomes, of course, would be many. You will have all the clinical and the non-clinical outcomes. What are the metrics which are used by the organization to measure your key performance indicators? How are you monitoring them? What are the improvements that are coming out of it? What are your clinical audits and your quality improvement projects, etc.? So when you look at these three buckets from a broader perspective, you know that a synergistic collaboration of the elements in a hospital would positively impact what we call as quality of. So coming to the benefits of accreditation, and more so with respect to the national accreditation that happens, NABH. So you have three primary groups which are affected, which are benefited. You have the customers, the hospitals, and the healthcare workers. And time and again, there has been a reiteration of the fact that it is our customers, it is our patients who are the greatest beneficiaries of accreditation. Because what accreditation would look at primarily would be patient safety. So, of course, from the patient's perspective, the benefits are high quality of care, patient safety. You understand the patient rights, which are respected and protected. Accessibility. So you have a reliable and certified information on facilities, infrastructure, the level of care, credentialed and privileged clinical staff, grievance that can be addressed directly to NABH. So once you are an NABH accredited hospital, you have customers who visit your hospital, they have a direct access where they can actually mail their grievances about the care which is being delivered by an NABH accredited hospital directly to the board, and they would mail us back and they would expect a closure from our end. So that brings about transparency to the entire system. Healthcare workers, of course, it provides continuous learning, good working environment, improved staff responsiveness, and higher employee satisfaction rates. For the hospital, you're promoting continuous quality improvement and patient safety, establishing optimum standards, professional accountability, and clinical excellence, improved statutory compliance. It provides framework and roadmap to improve the quality of care by focusing on all your departments. It is just not about a department, or it is just not about a set of healthcare workers. Accreditation basically acts as an impetus to fill in all the deficiencies in the care. So this is also true, like how I was emphasizing on the regulations, which were made by the IRDA. So this would be more apt in the rural areas as well. These are some of the studies which have basically been carried out with respect to the benefits or the importance of NABH accreditation. So these are some of the references which I have given, wherein the outcomes, of course, has been positive. This is just a screenshot of the NABH statistics as what is available in some of the journals and also in one of the newsletters that NABH itself publishes on a regular basis. So what you can see is as of June 2019, the total number of hospitals with any level of accreditation has been about 2,998. And as of Feb 20, the source of this information has been the NABH Quality Connect newsletter, which it publishes on a regular basis. So you can see the number of the accredited hospitals along with the certification programs put together has gone up to around 6,000 something. So this is just a screenshot of where we stand with respect to NABH accreditation and the empanelment programs in the certification programs. Challenges, of course, what I have not focused here would be on some of the facts in the government hospitals, the primary healthcare centers, and the community healthcare centers. I have just put in a larger perspective of what are the challenges from the organization's purview. So this, of course, I'm sure that most of you would have heard of killing the rumors. So either they say that NABH would just be a regulatory requirement, or they would say NABH is too difficult. It increases your documentation. It increases your cost, like how Dr. Leena was just emphasizing on. but always understand that it only provides the framework. And to harness the power of an accreditation, it basically depends on how your organization would want to respond to it. Now, what works for one hospital does not have to work for another. This is a very common mindset that we come across, wherein they say that this a particular policy or a particular protocol has to be in a certain way. Now, NABH would only tell you what is their expectation. Now, how you do it and how you ensure that you're fulfilling those objective elements would definitely be the organization's prerogative. Now, when we say teamwork, we actually mean teamwork. So once you have a quality department which is constituted, they always feel that it is the the onus for getting an accreditation would be on the quality team. But please understand that when the accreditation happens or when the assessors come in, what they would look for is the organization's commitment to continuous quality improvement. And it is never, or it can never be, a one person's job. So when we actually say teamwork, it means that everybody at all levels would have to be actively involved and ensure that accreditation would only be a way of ensuring continuous quality improvement. In the sense, it has to become habitual. It has to become your culture. Complacency. Complacency is again one more impediment that we see, that once you finish the accreditation, you get complacent. But unfortunately, NABH, or in fact, quality itself, would be a continuous process. In this sense, it is not something that you do one time and you leave it. They would look for continuous efforts, continuous improvements from the organization. And every time they come back, your standards would just go up that much higher. And like how I've mentioned, I think more than once, saying that quality is always a journey, not a destination. So to conclude, I would say accreditation has been accepted globally as a regulatory intervention to set the standards and monitor the quality of care. It is imperative to understand that NABH shall only provide the framework for us to align our internal systems so that we can maximize our quality of care. But the onus of imbibing a culture of quality and ensuring that it is an integral part of us as an organization definitely lies with each and every one of us. Thank you. These are some of my references. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Soumya. I think most of the attendees already were getting a feedback that, you know, they've got a very clear idea about the NABH and JCE accreditation and how important it is for any hospital. It is nothing to do with the return of investment. It is more about that will automatically come once the quality standard and safety is uplifted. So now the session is open. Before that, I would like to invite Dr. Dinakar sir. Dinakar sir?
Prashant?
Yes, sir.
So beautiful talks. Very nice talk, informative. Just I thought I'll ask both the speakers what I have encountered, because quality is definitely, yes. Regarding the quality, there are so many sessions are going on, and the national level, international level, hospital level, intra-hospital level, inside the things, everywhere. It's correct, madam. Whatever you people told, correct. Just one thing, later anybody can ask. It has made us NABH only. It's very good. And definitely, because we are all opening the hospital, we are going to accredit it. It has become like this. Sorry to use this word. It has become like this for the insurance. Just entry level NABH is necessary, so we will take it. No, I am telling you truth. Many people, whoever my friends, have opened the hospital entry level accredited. They are taking. Later, their nurses and even some people are feeling too much work than treating the patient. So writing, and the patient care is going off. And many people, when we were sitting, New Zealand people are somewhere, I don't know which country, they have removed the NABH, they are telling, because of patient care is more important than writing. Anyhow, we were doing, is it true or not? So that was my opinion. Please let us know about this.
So, Dr. Dinakar?
Yeah, please.
Yeah. So I think you basically focused on two points here. One is increased documentation in terms of NABH accreditation. That is one, isn't it? Where you feel that the quality of patient care obviously would go down. But I think, like what I said, what is applicable to one hospital might not be applicable to the other. So usually, when you plan or when you decide that you would go for an accreditation, it is imperative for us to understand and interpret the standards and the objective elements, because there are different ways in which you can actually look at interpreting the standards, fulfilling the requirements, and also having minimum documentation. So that's exactly why I said that what is applicable for one hospital might not be applicable for another. So now, especially with the digitalization of medical records and everything, the amount of documentation automatically comes down. So I think it depends on how an organization is looking at implementing those standards and the interpretation of standards, rather than probably emulating another hospital, saying that these are the documents which are available in the hospital, they are already NABH or JCI accredited, so let's do the same. So I think you need to have an individual approach when it comes to implementing the NABH standards and objective elements, keeping in mind the kind of staff that you have, the kind of electronic medical records that you have. That would make the process much easier. That is, that's my submission here.
But electronic EMR, electronic medical records, either it is not much validated in either MCI or medical legal aspects, or even in a NABH level, there should be a documentation they are asking. So EMR is, because full hospital we are doing EMR complete, including syringe pump, we are making the electronic medical record, this thing, but it's all not valid because sister has to write in the case sheet for MCI or for the medical legal aspects. So EMR is not much valid, even though because only storing purpose, we are storing it. Sister is writing as usual, same.
I would still ask you to just relook at it, because we have hospitals which are completely dependent on electronic medical records, apart from the minimum documentation like your consents, which of course cannot go on an electronic medical record, and they are accredited. So,
madam, just can you, because I am, we are really interested. We are really interested, not arguing, really interested, because minimal thing, EMR, minimal handwriting and maximum EMR. Any hospitals in India, madam, said that we can go and take some knowledge about that.
So from whatever little I know, I can actually quote you the example of Columbia Asia, which is completely paperless. And they are accredited. So, they only have their consents and the other basic documentation which is required, but everything else is on an electronic medical record. That, brings down your documentation to a great extent, even with respect to all your quality indicator, KPI reports, or your MIS reports. So.
Okay.
So if I may, I can just.
Madam, please, please, madam.
I just wanted to add on here that, this complaint of excessive documentation, which is necessary, is a very common thing which we have heard in accredited hospitals and labs also. But the thing is that it is all very important to note down certain things. Like, for example, as Dr. Soumya also said, if you have the standard and you are able to show that this is the interpretation of the same, then you can only write down those facts which are necessary, because whatever is the accreditation body, you need to show that you are complying with a standard. It may not be that you are following A, B, C, D, etc., but the intent and the compliance both have to be shown. It doesn't have to be that you fill up volumes and volumes of nurses' case sheets and which is not useful, because sometimes we have seen records where they say every hour the patient temperature 98, after half an hour 1 hour patient's temperature 98.4, again after 1 hour 98.2. So these kinds of things, maybe some of them may be redundant. So you need to basically, the person who is in charge of the quality or something can do a kind of a focused audit and see, okay, these things are not necessary, but still it shows that this standard is complied with. So that is how you can do a balance. But definitely one thing I can say is that wherever there is document, it has really helped a lot. And especially in many cases, it has actually prevented or helped in the court of law. So you have to make it very practical. And assessors do not actually look for a complete word by word thing, but the main thing is the hospital should be having the intent to follow the standard. I think we have to be very practical about it.
Yes, madam. And another question, madam. In the quality improvement in the hospital, for 3 people, is there any, like a 5 points, 6 points, is there anything, is there for the nurses, number one? Number second is para nurses means paramedical force, like a ANMs or OPD staff helping people, and quality improvement for the reception, GRE or whatever you people will tell. We will tell front office people. Is there anything like a points, something quality improvement, hospitality improvement for each and individual person? Is there any books or any points or any teaching things are there?
Yeah, so is Dr. Soumya answering this or?
No, Dr. Leena, you can answer.
Okay, yeah, so see, there is what we normally do is you can make a kind of, so for example, you mentioned about say customer care or something. So normally they need to be aware of the departments which they are handling. So customer care normally in different areas have different roles. So we could make what normally people do is you make small little booklets of the standards which they are supposed to read, because the entire thing is not necessary for them. So this has to be, that's how many organizations do it. You can make little booklets of the standards and give it to the relevant people, or some kind of a checklist that if it's a ward, then these are the things which they need to know, which they are handling in their purview. So that is one thing. Plus, I think, so they will not be able to read, or it's not necessary also for them to read the entire standard books. So that is one option. And make a checklist for them, which is useful. That can be done by the quality team or by the in charges, whoever it is. And the third option can be that I think internet has a lot of resources, especially for nursing people, because they have very small and, you know, very compact write-ups, which they can also go through. And as I said, main thing what the assessors look for is that a person of that area should be confident of what he or she is doing. So a customer care person who is handling a front desk should know about the hospital, should, and may, about where the infrastructure related things, as well as the part which he or she is handling. So if they're disposing, if they're giving off the lab reports, they should know about that part of it. If they're in a customer care in the ward, then they should know where the patient beds are, where the fire exits are, where, what are the nurses. So that kind of practical thing is necessary. So I think that's the main thing what assessors look for.
See, one thing, when we leave the car for the service in any showroom, suppose if we will use the restroom either in a hire, there will be a just backside of the door. When we close, we can see one thing is hanging there. It's in the cover. Every half an hour, what all the things they should do, they will come purposefully. Yes. We sat there till the service is over. It will definitely take 1-2 hours.
Yes.
So in that, every half an hour they will come, they will do the things, then they will recheck. Like that,
yes. Checklist.
I have searched in the internet for the night duty staff checklist. Is there under front office checklist? Because is there anything quality improvement in the hospital? Not only NABH, not only something. Is there anything like that each subject in the hospital? Checklists are available. You know anywhere where it is available? Checklist for front office. Checklist for OPD nurse, checklist for, please.
So Dr. Dinakar, my suggestion here would be these checklists, right, would be usually organization specific, because they are based on the standard operating procedures and your service standards that you would want to provide as an organization. So I don't think it would be that easy to duplicate these checklists from one organization to another. But like, you know how Dr. Leena was telling a while ago, either you can have checklists which are based on the standards, you know, applicable to that particular department, or what are your standard operating procedures? Because your standard operating procedures, your policies and protocols would be made keeping in mind your service standards also, all your operational protocols. So the checklist can actually be derived from this, and the quality team can very well help you, you know, in formulating all of this.
Yeah. Thank you, Madam. Prashant? Dr. Prashant?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, whatever. I had my doubts. Thanks for allowing me to ask. So if anybody is there, please.
Yeah, I request our participants, if they have any doubt, they can unmute and ask our expert speakers. See, there is one question which has come. Suppose if there is any incidence of drug, improper dose of drug being given to the patient, what should be the timeline to solve this incident report?
So just to answer that question, Dr. Leena, may I?
Yeah, please go ahead. Yeah.
So incidents, of course, you know, an easier term would be variance. So any variance which is not in accordance with your routine operations would warrant an incident report to be, you know, raised. So that is number one. Now, based on the question that you've asked, wherein there has been a wrong medication or a wrong dose. Am I audible? Hello?
Yes.
So, based on, of course, the wrong drug or the wrong dose which has been administered, we classify incidents into four categories, wherein we have a no harm, near miss, adverse, and the sentinel. So what NABH mandates would be, in case it's a sentinel event would be a physiological harm that has been caused to the patient and where the effect lasts at least for a minimum period of 2 weeks. So if it comes and falls under the category of a sentinel event, then you will have to finish your root cause analysis and CAPA within 24 hours, considering it is a sentinel event. But having said that, the organization is free to set the timelines for the other types of the incidents. So usually you have an escalation matrix wherein we say that within 24 hours, all these incidents, irrespective of whether there's been any harm or the categorization of the incident, you will have to report it within 24 hours. But, you know, as a regulatory requirement, we say all sentinel events, RC and CAPA has to be completed within 24 hours. That's only for sentinel. But the organization is free to define the timelines for the rest of the incidents as well, the categories of the incidents. So usually we give about 48 hours for the rest of the incidents.
Thank you. There is one more question. Suppose if there is any sedatives which has been kept in the locker, like morphine, fentanyl, and other sedatives, pethidine. So if it goes missing, how we should report it? Should we report to police about this, or how we should do it?
So in case, again, in case it is a narcotic, any breakage, in fact, just not a loss or a theft, has to be reported to your regulatory authority for narcotics. So I'm sure you will have a person who's designated, you know, who takes care of all the narcotics licensing part and the regulatory part of it. So you'll have the excise inspector, basically, who's being designated for that particular area, the jurisdiction in which your hospital comes. So just not the theft, even a breakage of a narcotic ampule has to be mandatorily reported to the excise inspector.
Yeah. Thank you. I think these are the few questions which I got it. So now I request our delegates, if they have any questions, they can unmute themselves and they can ask, or they can put it in the chat box. We'll see in the conversation. Yeah. Not seeing any question. All right. I think we've come to the today's end of session. Once again, thank you very much for accepting our request to be part of, you know, part of speaker for our LNF webinar series. So your inputs are very, very valuable, which has come out of a lot of experience. And the fluency and the way the practical things are put across during the webinar was wonderful. On behalf of NNF Karnataka State Chapters, thank you very much for sparing your time and sharing your experience, your invaluable experience with all of us. Thank you, thank you. So I would like to thank our delegates as well, who have been consistently participating and very keen on learning, and their question has been very, very specific, and they're showing a lot of interest, and we're getting very good reviews and feedback. And this topic was very important because most of the hospital, they have to go eventually with NABH and JC accreditation because of the insurance purpose. And say not only that, you made it very clear that quality, safety is beyond any accreditation. So that should not never be compromised on. It doesn't matter what it costs. At the end of the day, safety of the patient and safety of the staff is at most importance. So thank you very much for enlightening us. So we will catch up again this coming Sunday with newer topics. Thank you, one and all. Have a great evening. Bye, bye, bye. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Soumya. Thank you, Dr. Leena.
Thanks, everybody.
Yeah.
Yes. Thanks for your time.
Thank you. And thank you, Ganesh. Ganesh ji, for your invaluable support in getting speakers, helping us in a very big way. Thank you, Ganesh ji. Thank you. Thank you, Anviti. Thank you. Thank you, one and all. On behalf of NMF Karnataka team, thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.